I would like to begin by thanking the organizers. I am in fact quite honored just to be here, and I have enjoyed very much these 2 days. We got a bad start, but since we got a delay, but things have gone very well in my opinion, and very happy to be here to give the last talk. I know that you are maybe already starting to think about dinner, perhaps. So I will try to not be too long, and I will at least spend part of the time being quite general, because I think that not everybody is working on this thing. So maybe this is a good idea. Myself, I haven't worked much on this either for since or before 2017. I started by a coincidence to look at deep learning models in 2017. And after that, we've done quite a few different things, but I focus only on a few of them today. So I will say something about the optimal control perspective, and a little bit about stability. And if time permits, I will also say something about the notion of equivariance, which we find is very important in this area. So, but let's start a bit soft here. Maybe I think you all know that machine learning, deep learning, neural networks, artificial intelligence, there are many names that are overlapping on this, is very much used today. And I found somewhere a very long list, and I just took out a small number of these topics that you see there. I'm not going to read them out loud, but you can see that there are many, many different places. And you know, if you use Facebook, if you are using your iPhone to recognize your face, and so on, there are, these algorithms are used. In the last talk by Peter, we heard about Smale's 17th problem. That's the second last problem that he mentioned in this collection, but there are in fact 18. And since you were the second last speaker and I am the last speaker, I should really say something about Smale's 18th problem, which is the last one, because it has exactly something to do with artificial intelligence. He's talking about this in relatively general terms, so there are not many concrete problems that he's mentioning there. It's just a general discussion about human and artificial intelligence. He goes on for a while, and in the end, he says, learning is a part of human intelligent activity. The corresponding mathematics is suggested by the theory of repeated games, neural nets, and genetic algorithms. So neural nets is really what my talk is also about. It's been an enormous increase in the interest of deep learning, as I think you all know. This is not completely updated. It was the most updated I could find on the internet from the webpage of Jeff Dean. And you see here the growth. The red comparison graph here is Moore's law that they are comparing to, which says something about how quickly computer power is increasing. So you see that the papers on the on artificial intelligence is increasing even faster. And the last thing, you can make a lot of jokes about this, but you see here that in 2018 there were already about 100 new papers appearing on archive every day. And if you have if you allow some time to sleep and eat and such, you will have to read one paper every 4 minutes if you want to keep up with everything that is going on. So this is of course impossible for most people, and I am in addition a very slow reader. So this is I think that if you hear people in artificial intelligence talk about it and promoting it, they are sometimes a bit, I don't know, panegyrical or euphoric about it. You hear statements like, we should stop educating radiologists. There's no point anymore because now we can do everything with machine learning. So this is something said in many different occasions in many different for many different things. So I have found this very nice article from ScienceNews. I thought it was much nicer to take a picture of the to take a photo of the newspaper itself, but you can actually find it also as nice text on the if you look on the internet. It's open to everyone. This is taking a somewhat more skeptical view and says something about things that can go wrong, and I will get a little bit back to that a little bit later. What people like to do is to show how the deep learning algorithms can break down is to construct what is called adversarial examples. I think some of this is very well known, and I'm sure that many of you have seen this before, but in any case, I just mention it, that here this refers to classification. You have an image and you want to decide if something is in the image. And here you see that you can add, there is a panda, you can add just a small amount of noise and you get a completely different characterization. It turns the panda into a gibbon. And here is another thing that is also close to my heart here in that I mentioned this thing about equivariance, that if you have an image, if you train an image and then you test with a rotated version of the same image, then you can also get very wrong answers. So there are some challenges related to these problems. Here I'm going to finish with a somewhat gloomy example here. Maybe you heard about this, Uber's self-driving car. Was equipped with this automatic system for navigation, and actually the car discovered some pedestrians, but it had been trained to avoid things like plastic bags flowing across the road, things like that, and it made a decision that this is nothing to worry about. And it hit and killed the person. So this is the person was killed. Yeah. So this is, and also in fact, what happened was that because this is not the guy who is sitting in the car has the possibility of taking over the driving, and but did not pay attention, and he was later charged and convicted, I think, for this. So. Anyway, this was a very gloomy example. I'm not going to do this again for the rest of the talk. So let's get to a little bit more into business. I was a bit inspired by something you said yesterday, Dennis, when you were talking about this thing of when you model something, some physics, you do this discreetly. Maybe you do a control volume or something like that. And then you let you let the size of the box tend to zero, and you get the continuous equation. And then later on, you solve this by reintroducing a finite, and that's exactly what we do here also. So, but I think that we have some good reasons for doing this. So I will get back to that in a moment. This is I should just mention that this particular work on optimal control formulation is joint with Martin Benning in London, and Elena, who is here, and Matthias Erhardt in Bath, and Carola Schönlieb in Cambridge. Okay, so let's get a little bit down to explain. I try to stay low on the technical stuff, but we have to do something here to explain the main things. So, and what do we mean by a neural network? It is nothing else than a map from an input space X, together with a parameter space theta into some output space y, so that we can compute for a set of parameters theta, we can compute for any input, we can compute phi of x theta, And the idea is that phi is approximating some kind of true function, some kind of ground truth, they call it, phi g, that goes from x to y. And our job is to try to select the parameters theta to be as close as possible uniformly for all x to this function phi g. Often the input space can... It's like curve fitting. It's almost like interpolation or something. It's just that the way we construct the network is nonlinear in the parameters, which is not the case in for instance, interpolation. And it's quite complex and not so easy to understand exactly what is the range of this and so on. But I will get back to that a little bit later. The input space is often of somewhat high dimension. It could be something like images or sound signals, things like that. The space of parameters we can choose usually what is the dimension. The output space can sometimes be of low dimension, not necessarily, but in classification problems, we for instance analyze images and we want to know if there is a cat in the image or not. And that's so then it's just 0, 1, cat or no cat. That is a possibility. It could be just a finite set, this y in the. We are talking mostly about supervised learning. So what we assume is that we have our data. Again, you can compare to interpolation. We have a set of samples, xi, yi, that we call training data. And our problem is just to select the parameters theta star so that we get approximately phi of xi theta star equal to yi for all the data that we have. The quality, however, is not so much measuring how well we manage to approximate the input data we have. It's more important to take new data that we did not use in searching for theta star and see how the model behaves on that. So I have to say a little bit more details about this because it's quite important how these functions are constructed. So what we usually assume is that we have a composition of k so-called layers, phi k minus 1 up to phi 0. And associated to each layer, we have a subset of parameters, theta k. So that this is the way it's constructed normally. And here I will mostly, there are many different types of neural networks. We call them architectures often. And here we will focus for reasons that will become clear in a while. What is called residual nets. And these are nets which are we use an iteration. Zk plus 1 is equal to zk plus h, which is just a parameter, times f of zk theta k for some appropriate function f that we choose in different ways. And then we do this in the residual nets. We do this over many layers, and when we come to the final layer, we keep the dimension of the spaces until the final one, and then we project onto the output space from the last. We can do this in many different ways, but this is kind of a standard way. So you can think about it this way, I think, without any problems here. A popular situation is that this f function that we just defined. That defines the iteration is some nonlinear function sigma of wk applied to z. We can think of z as a vector here and plus some bk, which is a bias. So wk and bk belongs to this space that we call theta before. So this make up the theta space for all the k. The sigma is a special type of nonlinear function that when it acts on vectors, it acts component-wise. So sigma can be thought of just as a scalar function that acts on every component of the vector. That why it is like that, I don't know, but this has been the case for neural networks for many, 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 many years, and we have just adopted this. I will say something because I was very inspired today, both yesterday by the talk of Gemma and also Joshua was saying something today about machine learning. So this thing about expressivity was very central, in especially in what or universal approximants, which I think is more or less synonymous. So if you look in the literature on neural networks, there are many, many of these expressivity or universality results, which tells you that within the ability of the network to approximate functions in some class. So I have just given one example that I just a random result that I just to show you how the results typically look like. So here you have in LP between RD X and RD Y, the W is the width of the network, and it says that if and only if you choose the width at least equal to the maximum of dx plus 1 and dy, so which is the dimensions of the input and output space, then
which is the k you had before?
Sorry.
What is the width?
So the width is this is okay. So this is maybe not so good for the example I just gave with the ResNet, but you can vary the dimension of these intermediate layers. And it says that what it essentially says is that if you choose W at least equal to the dimensions of the dx plus the maximum of this, then you can make, by taking enough layers, you will achieve this. So
width has the number of layers?
No, the width is not the number of layers, is the dimension of the intermediate spaces.
It's the number of nodes in the intermediate
layer. Yeah.
In each node, you get the data, and you do this sigma of blah, 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 blah.
Exactly. But it's a little bit maybe misleading here, because I showed you an example of an architecture where W is essentially equal to dx, I guess, something like that.
Called the rule of the fact, depth of a network is the number of layers, width is the number of parameters in the layer.
Yeah, more or less. At least the first thing you said is definitely the case. So. So this is just a result. I didn't want to make a big focus on this. I just want to say that you can find many of this type of results, and you can change the class of functions, and you can change many different things. You can decide to fix the depth and make the width bigger and so on. And there are many results on that. But what is more important, in my opinion, is that you should not sit down and relax and think that your problem is solved when you have such a universality result, because there are other problems which are maybe more difficult to address. For instance, the stability of the network with respect to initial data or the parameters of the model. It is quite well known, and I think the first examples I showed also with the car and so on shows that if you make small perturbations to the data or the model, you can get completely different results. And also, there are some results very recent about saying even that there are stable networks. There exist values of theta star that makes them stable. It is just that your training, that I will get back to in a moment, the way of searching for the theta star is such that you will never find these stable networks. So this is a paper by Hansen, for instance, in Cambridge, and some co-authors that could be interesting to read for this. I will not pursue this in this talk anymore.
Is this impossible?
No. So these are always expressed in terms of probabilities and things like that. But I don't even know the details of the results myself. So I will not say anything more about this. Let me say something about how we do this. What we do is we have to write down an objective function for the network, so that we first define a function L, and then we can write down a functional that we try to minimize, which the L is the loss is used to measure the loss for one piece of data, and then you can run this over many data points. Take the average, and usually it's good to always add a regularizer, R of theta, because if you don't do that, you will typically get solutions in theta that varies between the layers with very high frequency, so very low regularity in as you go over the layers. Now I have to say I have to get back to what I mean by regularity here, but I will do that in a short moment. So now comes what I announced before, that what you can do in here is that this H that I wrote down in the ResNet iteration, you can let it tend to zero, and then divide by H on each side of the iteration. And you will see. Maybe we can go back to the and have a quick look at the iteration again. Yeah, there we are. So you see that this is nothing else than the explicit Euler method applied to the differential equation that I just wrote down. So here we use the explicit Euler method, or we recognize our. So this ResNet was discovered long before they started to think about even this differential equation. But then somebody, it's not so difficult to see that this is nothing else than an approximation of the solution to the continuous problem. So here you have to think that your number of layers tend to infinity, and it becomes a continuum, the layers with a continuous variable t. Okay. I should maybe say a bit more careful. So as a continuous optimal control problem, we can now say that we compute the minimum of this functional e of theta, subject to the satisfaction of this differential equation with the initial data as initial value. What you can do now is that you can use this Hamilton-Pontryagin principle, and you can rephrase this into a Hamiltonian boundary value problem. So you can write down a Hamiltonian h of z p theta, which is the, if you like, a duality pair. You have to introduce a set of Lagrange multipliers p in the dual space, and then you can write down a Hamiltonian function. And you now have a set of differential equations, a Hamiltonian system, and the constraints that gives you the vanishing gradient with respect to the parameters you see is the last equation. But this is a boundary value problem, because on the left side you have the data, on the right hand side you have a condition which comes from the final layer, which we have written down there. It's not a very complicated result to show. Now I would like to give some remarks about what we've done so far. And first, I already said, I think, that you can view this continuous formulation as the deep limit, as we call it, when the number of layers, the depth of the network, tends to infinity. There is, in fact, some result about that you can prove existence and convergence of a minimizer to this continuous optimal control problem in the deep limit. But it's necessary to get this. You need to regularize on the derivative of theta. That's what I said, that you get if you look at the numerical experiments on this, you will see that the parameters vary wildly as you go over the through the layers. One thing which is a bit awkward about this situation is that if you let so remember that we have a set of parameters for every layer. If you let this tend to the continuous limit, you let the number of layers, but also the set of parameters, the dimension of the parameter space, tend to infinity at the same time. It's a little bit difficult to handle and difficult to understand exactly how to make sense of it. We have done some work on this, but I'm not going to discuss that today. One thing one can also notice is that if you think of this training procedure as one phase where you are actually determining the theta of t, the optimal theta of t, once you know what this is, you want to run new data through your network to put it into production in a sense. And then this is nothing else. This has just become a non-autonomous problem. Because now the theta is to be considered a known function of time. And so you have a non-autonomous problem. So I will also get back to what we said before as a remark, that what you do now when you have this continuous problem is that you go back to the discrete because you don't know how to solve this exactly. So you introduce some numerical methods. But you have a little bit more tools at hand now, because now you can decide to use any kind of numerical discretization method. And there are many, many of those. And we know a lot about them because we've been working on them for 30, 40 years or something. So we know a lot about this. And we don't have to just stick with the good old explicit Euler method anymore, but we can use anything, and we can optimize our network by looking at the properties of the integrator. And we can also do analysis on this because this is somewhat easier sometimes to analyze the continuous problem than the discrete problem. So this is also something that we would like to do. This brings me over to the next section here, which is I would like to say something about the stability of some of these architectures. We worry about a situation where a small perturbation of the initial data leads to something completely different in the other end of the network, right? So this is not good. So this suggests that, because we know a lot about how to do stable models for ODEs, for instance, and also the numerical methods we apply. So we can use those tools that we know so well. If we constrain the network by imposing stability results, you should be aware that this will limit the expressivity of the network. And it may make it harder also to find the optimal solution, the optimal parameters. And you may also get reduced accuracy in the generalization. So generalization means when you apply your network to new data. So you should have good reasons for doing this. And one such reason is robustness against these adversarial attacks. And also, you should have a trade-off. You shouldn't lose too much accuracy of the model by doing this. So you should think carefully about what kind of stability to be imposed. I will say something also to review a little bit what has been done before. There is a paper, early paper from 2017 by Haber and Rototto. What they do is to linearize the model to study stability, in order to study stability. So, and they then look at the eigenvalues of the Jacobian of the system for different architecture. We know that if you have a linear autonomous problem, it is uniformly stable if the eigenvalues are negative. But for nonlinear and particularly non-autonomous problems, this is no longer the case. You can have all the eigenvalues in the left half plane, and still there can be exponential growth. So this is a weakness of the approach of Rototto and Haber. And we have done some numerical tests that show that this is not something just theoretical, but it also happens in practice, that even if it looks like the model is stable, it is actually not.
Here is one thing that also Haber and Rototto, we are not leaving them immediately.
One thing they do is that they try to change the F to make this more stable. You can do things like replacing the W matrix with the here I think I've done something wrong. I've forgotten to multiply by Z here. Sorry about that. But they take a skew symmetric, they skew symmetrize the matrix, and then they subtract the multiple of the identity matrix to get something more. But this is kind.
Where should you multiply by Z?
I think that I should make a parenthesis around before there and after there and put a Z. Sorry about that. And then you can also try to do Hamiltonian-inspired architecture. So actually make the F Hamiltonian. And you can do that just by suggesting some Hamiltonian. This is done in different ways by Haber and Rototto. But this is problematic. We have tried to analyze this. And to analyze autonomous Hamiltonian problems is easy. And almost everything is known about this. But if it's not autonomous, it is no longer so clear how to do this. So we have tried to do analysis of this non-autonomous case, but so far we don't have any useful results on this this thing.
Can I ask?
Very good point, because that's I said before that we have found a way to deal with this non-autonomous that we haven't, that I will not talk about today. And that's exactly what we do. We use something called switching systems, where you take intervals, and that also solves the problem of the parameters not tending to infinity as you let the, so there are some things about that, but I don't have time to go into this today. And I think that I will have to. I see that time is running very fast, so I have to just move on to say what I want to say, because what we have tried instead is to use the notion of contractivity. It is really better, more correct to call it non-expansiveness, but we traditionally it's called contractivity in the ODE literature. So this is something. If you can choose F in such a way that it satisfies this monotonicity condition star for some inner product on your space. That's the inner product, yes. That's the inner product. If you can do that with a constant nu that can depend on time, then you will get this behavior of the norm of the solution. And if you can manage to select your problem such that this nu can be taken non-positive, you get, then we call it contractive. It should really be non-expansive, but okay. You can also, there is a rich theory for this also for numerical methods. So it's exactly known in the big class of numerical integrators called Runge-Kutta methods, that they inherit this property. If the Runge-Kutta method satisfies certain conditions, and I have written this down, I can see that if you are not a Runge-Kutta expert, this doesn't make much sense. But this class of Runge-Kutta methods can be parameterized by a matrix A and a vector B. And if you put some conditions on these parameters, then you will get this BN stability property. This is called algebraic stability. So The problem, one problem is that you cannot combine this with methods which are explicit, meaning that for every time step you go, you need to solve a nonlinear system, which is very expensive. But it's actually possible at the cost of limiting this step size that you're using in integration. And you can still get something which is contractive or non-expansive, but you have to replace the monotonicity condition and then with something slightly different. So this is something that we have done experiments on, and we have some reasonably good results on this also. I think that I will just skip over here because, yeah, so this this is related to something called circle contractivity. I think that I will just jump over this also. This is, I'm sorry, but I'm taking this from a different talk, and I think it's maybe too detailed here. Yeah, but in any case, what you can achieve is that you can get this contractive behavior also for explicit numerical integrators. Okay. What could perhaps be more interesting to discuss here is how do you choose the F in order to obtain contractive vector field? And there is one easy way to do this is to take a minus W transpose sigma of W z plus B. I see I should have written W of T also inside, but sorry about that. Because this turns actually out to be a gradient system. And if you define the gradient in a certain way, and you can prove then that you will get a contractive behavior for this system, so we have some details about that just by choosing F in this way. If you solve the ODE exactly, you get something, and if you want to use a numerical method, you have to be careful also with how you choose the numerical method, but you can make this monotone if you like. One thing that we've done, I just mentioned briefly, is that we have tried, this is what Antonella was just asking about, these switching systems. What you can do then is to switch between systems which are contractive, expansive, and neutral in a sense. And you can even learn, let the model learn when you are going to use something contractive, when you are going to use something expansive. And you can do this in a controlled way so that the overall system from input to output is one Lipschitz or contractive, if you like. Yeah. And this is also something that we've been working on.
Intuitively, how does the learning avoid the bad cases?
I think... So what happens, you mean, if you do something with a contractive map, then it will mean that nearby data will also be nearby at the other end.
Yeah. But what if you're in the expansive part? What's it going to say?
If you use the expansive part, yeah. But what we can do, what we do is that we estimate the growth over the short intervals, and we make sure to compensate that by running it in a contractive manner for a longer period of time if we have to do that. And there's a way that we can control this overall Lipschitz constant, one-sided Lipschitz constant that I was mentioning before, so that we can achieve what we want to do. So this can be done. Okay, how am I doing time-wise, sorry. I should have really we stop now, or? 11 minutes. Oh, yeah. Okay. So, yeah. Sorry. I thank you. now I'm happy. I will say a little bit about equivariance. Not very much, but I just give you an idea. Here is an interesting example, because what we've done here, we have done a very, very simple case, and which is about denoising an image. So, to the left, if you look at the upper row, to the left you have the clean image, and then we have added some noise in the next image, and then we have tried to do an ordinary denoising, And then something which I will get back to, which we call equivariant, but which is such that it is somehow insensitive to rotations of the input image. And you see what happens is that in the first case, we have trained with horizontal stripes, and everything works nicely. But you see that if we try to do the same experiment, we try to test with vertical stripes, then with noise on them, you see that the ordinary one is not working at all anymore, because the training is only used to see horizontal stripes and not vertical stripes. Whereas if you do this in an equivariant manner, it actually understands that this is, yeah, intuitively, that this is just a rotated version of the horizontal stripes. So this is something which is quite interesting, and it evolves a little bit of geometry. I'm not sure how much I have time to say. Okay, this is things that you, of course, are familiar with, that what it means with equivariance. So we have a fixed group G, and that can act on different spaces. And then it's just this relation, f of g x, g acting on x is equal to g f of x. And we have the good thing about this is that if you compose two such maps that are equivariant, you get something equivariant, and that helps you to keep the equivariance through the whole network as long as you are equivariant in every layer. And So for differential equation, then equivariance is often closely connected to symmetry groups. But what we would like to do in image classification, as you saw in the example, is it is often the case that it should be invariant under rotations, translations, or even scaling. So if you have a cat in your image, you want to know it's a cat, it shouldn't matter which way the cat is rotated. Mm-hmm.
Like Arnold
cat, yeah, that's right. So maybe you should have something under the symplectic. So this is what we try to do. And in order to achieve this, I don't know how much I should say about this, but the way that you can do this is to think of the images or the intermediate spaces as being sections of a fibered space, so that the image itself is defined on the base, and then there is a fiber over there that you can use to keep track of these rotations. So the base will typically be the pixel positions in an image, and in the fiber you can do whatever you like, but there are certain ways of choosing these fibers such that you can obtain this equivariance thing. So what you do technically is that you take a group G that acts on the whole fiber bundle, and then you need for each layer a closed subgroup, so that you look at the homogeneous space, we divide out this H. And then what you need to do in this case is to do convolutions. That's what you have to do, and you have to do convolutions on the group G. And then what you can do, I don't know, I think maybe if you try to impose on such a model equivariance, the first thing you get is that it's that this kernel is going to be a convolution kernel. You start by something more general. But when you start to impose equivariance on this expression here, you immediately get that the k has to depend only on one variable, so it becomes a convolution. But then, in addition, you need also a representation for each of the consecutive layers, and you need also there to have a condition like this. So this limits actually quite a bit what you can achieve, but you can do it, but only if the acting group is unimodular. But some of the more interesting examples, this is already the case. So so this is This works for the linear part, and then the non-linearity. If you want the non-linearity, you have to replace the, what you did before, and you have to do something different in order to keep the equivariance. So there is something called the gated non-linearity, where you can actually also achieve this. You can also include these biases, this extra vector b that can also be included in the non-linearities. So this is possible to do, and we have done this and applied it in different settings. For instance, in a problem with what was it, denoising, wasn't it, Elena? Where we tried this out, I think. So this works well. I think that I will stop there, actually. So thank you for your attention.